please welcome Chelsea Handler.
Cocktails and everything. This is my kind of show.
Yes, yes. I love this. I love them. I don't want to get in your way there with that.
What's up, girl?
What's up, girl?
How are you?
Long time.
Nice to see you. Nice to see a friendly face.
Yeah, she worked for Jo.
Is that Koy?
Koy?
Yeah, that guy named Jo Koy.
Oh, that is my penetrator. I am very familiar with his work.
Yes. Dating, I've never dated a comic. What's it like to date a comic? You got two incredibly funny people in one fucking house. That has to be unique.
Well, you know, it's funny that you say that because I had never dated a comic either. I don't even think I've really slept with many comics, maybe one or two in my 20s, mm-hmm. but not an exorbitant amount because I always found male comedians to be slightly narcissistic, you know? I don't know you well enough to know if you're a narcissist, but I'm just gonna assume that you are. And they're either narcissistic or they're a little bit dark, you know? Male comics can be dark, and that kind of energy is...
Can't help that part. I can correct my ego, but this shit right here.
Yeah, exactly. So I was, but Jo Koy is neither of those things. He is a gem of a human being. Wow. And so to meet a man, and that's how I first became attracted to him, because we had been friends for many years, mm-hmm. and he used to be on my TV show all the time, and we used to give each other so much shit. And I looked at him like, you know, he was my little brother. I was never going to allow penetration to happen. And we started hanging out, you know? And he came to one of my shows in Las Vegas. I was playing the Mirage in Vegas, which I'm sure you've played. Mm-hmm. And he came backstage, and he was so available. I was nervous because I was putting up a new hour of material, and I was really, I wasn't in my groove yet.
Yeah,
and
yeah.
He was so sweet with me backstage, and I just remember thinking, this guy is like, he's got his own deal going on. Like, he gets up in front of tens of thousands of people and performs, and yet here he is available for me in my moment and being sweet and kind of keeping people away from me in my moment to focus before I went on stage. And I remember looking at him thinking, I'm gonna get you.
See, the reason this is strange to me is I've been around you maybe twice, and the one time, Jo was there and Lonnie Love was there. And when I did your show.
Uh-huh.
And they were on the panel. And I would have lost all my money if I bet against this. Because was there anything back then? I mean, he didn't try to fuck you back then.
No. He actually didn't try to fuck me this time either. I actually had to make the move because Jo is such a sweet guy. He was never gonna make a move on me. And he was right, because any guy, I mean, if you're a girl, you've hung out with men who you know are trying to sleep with you, and you just think, I'll hang out with them for as long as this situation is manageable, you know? And then if they cross a line, you're like, okay, you're out. I can't hang out with you anymore. You did the wrong thing. But with him, he wasn't ever doing that. He never was making a move. And I finally had to make the move, you know, because I knew he wouldn't. He respects our relationship too much, and he respects women too much. And that's also one of the reasons I became more attracted to him. I was like, this guy isn't even trying to have sex with me. Like, you know? It's a turn on.
Yeah, yeah.
And you know, not that every man wants to have sex with me, but you know, when you're hanging out with somebody a lot, you think, oh, they're here for one reason. So it's nice to find out that he was here for other reasons. And yeah, and then I had to audition the sex, you know, obviously, because there's no potential. You have to make sure all your pieces fit and match and that there's room for everybody, you know, to thrive. And so I made the move. I made the first move. I did the first kiss. And even then, he said, we were in Vegas. He said, I'm not doing this in Vegas. He said, I've been waiting for this for 15 years. If this is happening, he says, it's not gonna happen in Vegas and it's not gonna happen like this. And then I was done for. I was like, oh, when's it gonna happen?
Yeah, that's cool. That's very cool. So he was attracted to you back in the day, and he just had to treat you like the boss.
Yeah, I think so. I think he was attracted. He likes to say that I was also attracted to him, and he can pretend whatever he wants to pretend. It doesn't matter, because the bottom line is I'm attracted to him now, and whatever it took me to get to this place, I'm here, and I'm down.
Yes, yes. And we're down, because we love... Are you all like me? I love them together.
Oh, thank you. Thanks, guys.
We had go girl, the dog pound over here. We had Quinta Brunson on last night. She is a writer, actress, and started as a stand-up. And she's really successful now and don't want to fuck with stand-up no more. Have you ever been in that position where you say, okay, I'm cheesed up, I'm not doing stand-up. It's too hard, it's annoying. You ever thought about stopping that?
Oh, yeah, yeah. I mean, when I came off my went off of Chelsea Lately and went into my Netflix show, I took 2 years off, or a year off, and didn't do anything. And at that moment, I was so burned out. I was doing one book and then a stand-up tour and Chelsea Lately for like 7 years in rotation. And I just kept going and going because, you know, when you first become successful, you feel like you've got to do everything and you want to lay that foundation for your, you know, later in life so that you don't have to work so hard all the time. Mm-hmm. So, yeah, and I got burned out. Nobody told me, nobody ever says to you, take a break. You know, your agents are never going to say you should relax and take a break. So no one said that to me, but I definitely felt burnout and I stopped doing stand-up for about 6 years. I just felt like I had nothing to say in that medium, you know? And it wasn't until like 2 years ago when I did my last special for HBO Max, I did a special called Evolution, which was based off my last book, where I had something new to say. I had an experience. I went to therapy for the first time as an adult. I got some self-awareness going. And I kind of thought, okay, I have a message now. Like I have, yeah. So now I'm back on track and it's nice because it's how I became successful in the first place. It's kind of my, you know, origin story, my roots. And Jo Koy also just kind of brings out that kind of stoke for stand-up, you know? Like, so I've been on this tour, Vaccinated and Horny, for a while, thank you. Yeah, I'm doing two shows at the Wiltern right after I leave here tonight. And pretty excited. And it's been going great, and I'm back into stand-up, you know? There's nothing like being in front of a huge crowd. There's just nothing like that.
Yes, yes, this is our therapy. Yeah. Well, it's part of our therapy, but I'm sure, like you mentioned, you've been to real therapy.
Yes, I have. Have you?
You know what? When I was separating from my kid's mom, I needed it. When you're dealing with custody and,
yeah,
and how to be a good dad, by yourself. Yeah, I was tripping. I went.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
I need to go again soon.
Yeah, everybody needs to go a little bit all the time, you know? Like, incrementally, when things pop up, it's good to bounce your ideas off of somebody else just to find out who the asshole is in the situation, you know? Because usually it's you.
Have you always gone to the same therapist? Do you have to shop therapists to find the right one?
Some people do. I mean, I was lucky enough. I interviewed this guy on my old show, my show on Netflix, this psychoanalyst or a psychiatrist. He was like an adolescent psychiatrist, I should say. There's a difference. So he...
Wait, and educate us. What is the difference again?
Yeah, who fucking knows?
Okay. But,
psychiatrists are allowed to prescribe medication, I believe, and that's the most important delineation for me. But anyway, I went to him, and he specialized in adolescent brain development, which I thought was perfect because I had the maturity level of like a 13-year-old girl for a long time. You know, like you get stuck sometimes in your life with different events that happen, and you kind of stop maturing sometimes if you don't deal with that pain or deal with that trauma or whatever it is for each person. So he was great for me. And no, I haven't been to another therapist since him because he's like, to me, the Dalai Lama. Like, yeah. Anytime I have a problem, I just call him up and he gives it to me straight. And I appreciate that. I don't go steadily anymore, but I'm sure there will come a time where I have something that I have to deal with. And I like to talk about it because, you know, I mean, LA, everybody talks about therapy, but the rest of the country, it's like, you know, it's still verboten in a way. And it's very good to talk about these things, you know? It's very unhealthy to not discuss your feelings and your emotions. And I did that for a really long time, so I speak from experience.
Yeah, see, when you asked me the question, what really went through my mind was, you grow up in the ghetto of Cleveland, or probably any ghetto, it's stigmatized, and you aren't supposed to go to therapy. You're supposed to maybe go to the pastor and talk. But black people, am I wrong? Black people don't go to therapy, and we really need them motherfuckers. You know, but black people, have you ever been to a therapist, sir?
I have, actually.
Good.
Yeah.
Good. Because you was talking to me during the monologue. This motherfucker talked to me during the whole monologue. I'm like, he need a therapist. What the fuck? I was like, so with my Yeezys and this, he was like, what the fuck are you talking?
Yeah,
like,
that's look, he's wearing pink pants. He's been to therapy. Yeah. That's a real man. Yeah, only a real man can come out with pink pants and be like, yeah, I've been to therapy. That's hot. It's sexy.
I know we got business that I got to take care of and all that kind of stuff, but I have to ask you about the Hollywood Bowl, the Chris Rock situation, DC Young Fly up at Tommy T's in Pleasanton. That didn't go well. The guy who walked on stage on DC knocked that motherfucker out. You know, so sometimes you see them coming. But what do you think about the assault on comedians and freedom of speech and all the shit we're going through?
Well, I mean, obviously, it's unacceptable for anybody to get up on the stage, you know, and from the audience ever. So unfortunately, you know, what happened at the Oscars sucked. I mean, and now we're seeing the reverberations of it. Like, it wasn't even just an isolated thing. It's like, oh, now there's people that want to copycat that. And as a comedian, you know, that's scary, but you know, we all have to beef up security when you're doing live shows. You can't have people approaching the stage. First of all, no one in the audience is paying to see that happen.
Right.
They're there to see a show. So it's so disrespectful, not to the artist only, to everybody else who's experiencing your ruining, you know, experience. So that's a bummer, you know, and hopefully it's just like a phase and nothing serious happens, and hopefully it's the end of it, you know.
Should we talk a little bit about the tour? It's vaccinated.
We can talk about whatever you want. We should plug
Koy's date. Isn't he someplace tonight?
Yeah, he's at the Chase Center in San Francisco tonight and tomorrow night, Friday night.
Damn.
Yeah.
That's a basketball arena.
Oh, I know. He plays huge arenas. He always wants me to go up when I'm with him. I'm in San Francisco tomorrow night too, but we're doing two separate shows. And he always wants me to go up with him. And the first time I went up with him, it was like 12,000 people at some arena in Portland. And I was like, you can't play comedy in front of this many people. And he's like, yes, you can. I go, do I have to adjust my timing? And then I went up, I was like, oh yeah, you can play comedy in front of this many people. It feels fucking terrific. Yeah. Anyone who's saying that isn't selling that many tickets, because when you do sell that many tickets, it's worth it. So yeah, he's crushing it. He's awesome.
Because I've talked that shit. Well, I like the intimacy of the Comedy Store's belly roll.
Yeah.
You know, but. One night I went on at the Honda Center with George Lopez, and I'm like, fuck the belly room. This is cool. So we don't have any clips I have to show or
anything. No, you don't have any clips.
I saw Peacock.
Oh, Peacock. I have a TV show coming out on based on the last book I wrote, Life Will Be the Death of Me. It's kind of like a Curb Your Enthusiasm. It's actually, well, with me starring in it, but about me going to therapy and, you know, taking two steps forward and then eight steps back. You know, you think you're really improving as a person once you start talking to somebody. Mm-hmm. Like, I once came out of therapy and I did like my first meditation that actually felt like I was meditating, you know, like the feeling that people tell you about. Because I was like, what am I doing? Just sitting here by myself. And then I felt it one day and I walked out of the office and I was like, hit my doctor's office and I was like, this is it, I'm fixed. Like, I'm meditating, I'm like, I got it. Like, I've only been to three sessions, but I probably don't even have to come back. And then I left and got into a huge screaming argument with the parking lot attendant, who I was convinced was using a fake Australian accent. That was what my argument was about. Yeah. So I'm screaming at him, he won't bring me my car. I'm like, you're not even Australian. And I get in my car, I was like, that accent is so stupid and no one believes it. And I get in my car and I'm driving off the lot out of the, you know, garage or whatever. And I'm like, what was that? I go, you just went to therapy thinking you're kicking ass. And then here you are screaming at some man who's working in a parking lot. Like, you are not fixed. You are still a bitch. And then, you know, I had to go back. I had to keep going back. You have to go back and back and back and back.
Oh, gosh. Okay, so when I met you, I was a guest on your show. That was an incredibly innovative show, which created careers for a lot of people, including your man, and like I mentioned, Lonnie Love and Fortune and all kind of people were there. Do you miss that?
I don't miss it. I don't miss that show. I needed to graduate from that show. Now, in the time that we're in, there have been conversations about revitalizing a show and doing some sort of Chelsea Later or something, just because I feel I get so frustrated with all this talk about how nobody can be funny while they're having to be politically correct. It's like, yeah, you can. All we're asking people to do is, you know, not. All we're asking people to do is not be racist and not be sexist. It's not that fucking hard, you know? And you could be a little bit more clever. So I feel like, and there's so many amazing comedians coming up. Otzko, who you're familiar with, obviously is one of them. There's so many amazing comics coming up right now. This is the time people want to laugh so hard. So I would consider revisiting it at this time in my career, because I just want to give room to that spotlight to so many people, and also to show and demonstrate that you can be funny without hurting other people's feelings, you know, and marginalizing groups.
That's incredible. And that's a perfect place for us to stop. Whatever you do, I'll be there. I know you all will be there. Give it up for the wonderful Chelsea Handler.